الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله ذي الملك والملكوت، ذي العزة والجبروت، الحمد لله حي قيوم لا ينام، عزيز لا يضام، قهار لا يرام. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلِّم تسليمًا. يقول الباري سبحانه وتعالى بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Will you believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and dare not except on the state of Islam. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, bestow upon us the gift to die on the state of Islam. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. Amma ba'd, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anfal says in the Quran, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعاكم لما يحييكم. Or you believe, respond to the call of Allah and His Messenger to that which give you life. And this ayah, dear brother, respected sister, it requires for us always reflection and pondering and coming back to really study this ayah more and more to understand the meaning of the istijaba. As we have mentioned it last time at the end of the khutbah, al-istijabatu, it has the structure of confirming and calling with insisting of the way of how to answer Allah and to respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is required mubadara, to hasten toward the answering of the call. Biduni ikrah, not feeling like someone is forced. Wala taraddudid, and without being indecisive or in a way thinking twice in the answering of the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So al-istijaba to here, and if you see the ayah, the structure of the ayah, everyone looking forward to have life. And the life, is it truly what is called life, is what is joyful in our life. The life that it has peace, because someone when he's going through difficulties, when subhanAllah is everything tight and every subhanAllah kind of falling down on their heads, it's not life. It's like they feel suffocated, they cannot even breathe. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the one who called you to the true life, despite the difficulty that someone will be going through. Answering the call of Allah, responding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give you that peace in the heart and give you that tranquility. Therefore, this answering really require, you know, a mabda, a principle, a beginning. This beginning, usually, by the nature of the human being, is to really start from the end. Whatever, you know, the end is going to be rewarding, then the person, he's going to put his and her drive and their willpower to achieve it. If there's an investment that brings you a lot of profit, you'll see everyone racing to invest in this type of investment. So when you look at the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every nafs is seeking for the blissful life, and the blissful life, the path of the blissful life in this life and the hereafter is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what ignites the nafs and the willpower into one soul to really commit and race for the good is the love of getting to this blissful life, the love of the achievement to have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleasure upon you. However, this longing for this blissful life, this longing for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that every Muslim, sincere Muslim, he has and she has. This is no doubt, because every Muslim want to be in paradise. Every Muslim want and seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But does the longing to seek the pleasure of Allah, does the longing for this blissful life imply the action, imply that someone will be automatically fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No, certainly not. So there is a big distance and a path, a long path between this longing that we have to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the fulfillment of the command of Allah. This path is filled with trial, with tribulation, with difficulties. And this path is very hard. And this path
is very difficult. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh when he asked him about the gates of the good, how to be admitted in the mercy of Allah. He told him, لَقَدْ سَأَلْتَ عَنْ عَظِيمٍ. You have asked about tremendous thing. But it's easy for whom Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for them. So that we are seeking the tayseer from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not we're going to get into this path with our own strength and our own power. No, we are inquiring the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it's going to be easy for us. However, most of the people from among the Muslims who wishing for this blissful life, they subhanAllah kind of locate and imprison themselves into a realm of wishful thoughts. Wishful thoughts. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called yatamanna ala Allah al-aman. So this realm of wishful thoughts is like someone, you know, whatever, you know, is dictated by their own soul, they do it. But yet they ask in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or wishing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. They say Allah is the most merciful, will be admitted in His mercy. Allah is the most forgiver, and the oft forgiven subhanahu wa ta'ala will be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, one soul is following their own whims. They're inclined to fulfill their desire. They're inclined to do whatever else is doing in this worldly life to gain the gains that they have, to imitate them in whatever toy they're acquiring. But when it comes to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything is fine. Why? Because we believe that Allah is merciful and He's going to shower us with His mercy. Now, we're saying this because we are in these blessed days. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always showed us in the season of the blessing, in the season of the A'yad, that someone is like close to Allah, near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will see always more people in this great season. People are more dedicated, more devoted. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Allah's gift on us to bestow upon us this favor for people to be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can we safeguard this nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If there is any obstacle, you know, between us and between safeguarding this mindfulness, safeguarding this, you know, state of the heart that is near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, racing for the good, racing for the good. Now when we're talking here, we say, the nature of the people is to follow, to be inclined to their desire. And then they will be thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mercy will be at their reach. At their reach, why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful of forgiving. And here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the difference between the two paths. The first path is the wise one. قال الكيس من دان نفسه وعمل لما بعد الموت. الكيس, the wise person, the wise who has integrity, the one who has truly sincerely want to achieve his and her purpose of life. قال دان نفسه. What is the meaning of دان نفسه? He called himself or herself accountable. They will be watching their action. قال وعمل, and they do noble deeds to benefit them to benefit them after their death. قال والعاجز, العاجز is the incapable one, the foolish one, the helpless person. The helpless person أتبع نفسه هواها. He followed his own whims. He made his nafs, the part of his nafs, to dictate the path. By dictating the path, designing what is the path, by fulfilling the desire of this nafs. And then قال أتبع نفسه هواها وتمنى على الله الأماني, and has wishful thoughts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give me everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and look subhanAllah how people they dare with no respect, with no veneration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the owner of the two guardians in Surah Al-Kahf. قال وإن رددت إلى ربي لأجدن خيرا منها منقلبا. And if I turn back to Allah, I will find better than this. So it's like subhanAllah, someone dictated on Allah to give him what he wants or what she wants. And this is subhanAllah how it turned for these incapable people, for these foolish people. They fooling themselves by saying this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us. Therefore, we are wishing for the blissful life, but yet we don't do the right action because there is a path. There is a path that we need to implement so to will be able to fulfill the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is this obstacle, what is this subhanAllah, this hajj, this veil, this gap between us and the fulfillment of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it the understanding of the Sharia? Is it the inability to understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When someone reads, he said, you know, I don't understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from me. The answer, of course, is not, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّنَّ الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَأَلْمِ الْمُدَّكَرِ. We have made this Quran easy to be remembered. If there is any one to remember. So most of the people, they read the Quran, but they do not read the Quran with the intention to remember, to understand, to say, Ya Allah, what we are supposed to do. Ya Allah, help me to get to your path. Ya Allah, help me to persevere on this way as or this state, the way that you help me and bestow upon me the gift to persevere on it in this day without my real effort. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you a gift. Look in Ramadan, subhanAllah. How people they come, how people they devoted. And even in the last these 10 days, most of the people, I'm sure, because they have the longing for this blissful life and the longing for the pleasure of Allah, they have fasted the day of Arafah. And everyone in this day of sacrificial, you know, sacrifice and give the sacrificial animal for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the taqwa of Allah, seeking to increase the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They know certainly, as we have said, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, does not reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the blood or the flesh, but what reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this sacrifice is your own taqwa. So what is really the gap, what is the obstacle between us, what we are wishing and the action that we need to do? The obstacle is the state of our heart and the state of our nafs. The state of our heart and the state of our nafs. And this is the obstacle. Now here, there is subhanAllah an ayah in the Quran, which is the remaining of the ayah that I have started with, which is really stand as a very scary and fearful ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after he said, respond Allah and his messenger to the call, to that which give you life. قَالَ وَعْلَمُوا. And you should know. And know, actually, know. أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. That Allah stands between a person and his heart. Person and their heart. And this is, dear brother, respected sister, it's very scary ayah. رَهِيبَةٌ رَهِيبَةٌ. Really tremble, make the heart to tremble. Which is mean, this heart that would between your own side, you do not have any ownership of it. It's in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُقَلِّبُهُ كَيْفَ شَاءَ. He turned it aside the way he will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. With his wisdom and justice and mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, when you think about it, if the obstacle between you and the nearness to Allah, if the obstacle between you and to fulfill the command of Allah, the obstacle between you and guaranteeing for yourself the pleasure of Allah and the blissful life is yourself, is your state of your heart. Is your state of your heart and your state of your nafs, of your soul. For this reason, the believer thinking of such a thing, then he will remind himself and remind ourselves that what stands between you and your heart is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is really scary, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may take the iman, the faith that he gave you as a gift at any time. As any time can subhanAllah withdraw it, take it away from your heart. And then subhanAllah someone turned to be a wicked person, a person subhanAllah helpless, he cannot do anything. But being mindful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stands between you and your heart, which is make a person subhanAllah to be aware. So this ayah really need to boost and spike the alertness into our system, to be alerted, to be aware. That subhanAllah, if you do not guide your heart the right way, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take it away from you, take away the iman from this heart. Now, if this heart is in the prison of the self, the prison of the self, what is the self? The self who is looking always to fulfill its desire. Then when this nafs is dictating the heart, then this heart is in the prison of the nafs, serving the desire, serving the whims. That's what the Prophet ﷺ قال أتبع نفسه هواه. And in this case, someone is making the action of shirk, dear brother, respected sister. It's truly the action of the shirk and the worst of the shirk. Why? Because in this way, the person is worshipping his own self and her own self. Why? Because when someone makes the heart to be in the service of the nafs, to get whatever desire, to be indulged in all the desire that the nafs is dictating to have, or the nafs is imposing to have, then someone, he's not worshipping Allah. For this reason, and at this specific moment, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turn away from this heart. He will let this heart, subhanAllah, to be succumbing, to be drowning into this prison of the nafs. Therefore, When someone Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turn away from them, then they will have subhanAllah the full seal on the heart. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قل آمنوا أو لا تؤمنوا, or the ayah قال سواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون, is equal to them. It's either you warn them and you do not warn them, they will not believe. They do not believe if there is shortcoming into the messenger or shortcoming into the message. Neither. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he is the one who fulfilled all the tasks that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fully and completely and with outstanding way, the conveying of the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the message of the truth. So the problem is in this tool or in this reception. The heart is dead. The heart is corrupted. And this is what we're talking about, a sound heart. A sound heart that is cleansed so it will be able to welcome the faith of Allah. To be welcome, to invite Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help. To invite Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to turn your heart into the right side. And here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching us how we need to be alerted for such a thing. He used to make much this dua that Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha reported and other of the companions. Ya muqallib al-qulub thabbit qalbi ala deen. O the one, Ya Allah, who turn aside the heart, make my heart to be firm on your deen. This is what we need today. This is you still remembering Allah, glorifying Allah after every salah. And if you do such a thing, make the dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you. To have a state of a heart that it will be inclined toward the forgiveness of Allah, inclined toward the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as it was his habit to really protect and shield himself from all this, subhanAllah, this subtle cunning, the thing that we do not see, that we do not perceive. He said, "Allimni ya Rasulullah, teach me something." So he told him a dua, it's like an amazing dua. The introduction of the dua, you see like what this dua is going to be. قَالَ قُلْ أَلَّهُمَّ عَالِمَ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادِ فَاطِرَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ قَالَ رَبَّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَمَلِيكِ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. Look, subhanAllah, the introduction, it's like what the dua is going to be after it. With the introduction, you see, this is subhanAllah, tremendous dua. So he said, "O Allah, the knower of the seen and the unseen, the originator of the heaven and the earth, the Lord of everything and the sovereign of all the kingdom of the heaven and the earth. I bear witness that there is no God except you." Is this introduction for what dua? "I seek refuge, Ya Allah, with you from the evil, my own self." So which is meaning, like the evil of your own self is the worst from all the evil around you. So subhanAllah, this introduction of the dua was celebrating the oneness of Allah, was celebrating the law, his lordship, his rububiyyah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and inquire him with his names and his subhanAllah attributes to just be safe and shielded from your own self. Therefore, we need to understand this is a principle. This is a principle. The state of your heart define your destiny. The state of your heart define who you are. The state of your heart define your future. One of the arifin, he said, "Qala ihfaz qalbak," is like ihfaz qalbak ihfaz hammak, is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking to you. Safeguard your heart. I free you from worrying. Safeguard your knowledge. I will safeguard your willpower and your determination and your drive to be getting into racing of the goodness and racing to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when you think of this beautiful saying, when you safeguard your heart and you keep it near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala free you from the worrying about this dunya. Free you from all subhanAllah this type of the anxiety which does not have any foundation. When someone, subhanAllah, is consumed by anxiety because of shortage of income or because of anything else, because this person, he does not have a belief in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why they consume themselves with worries and with grief, and then what it turned to be depression and so on. Why? Because he does not have this hafz of the qalb. And then the hafz of the knowledge, to safeguard your knowledge, not the knowledge of being engineer or doctor or being, subhanAllah, whatever, you know, great, successful business person. This knowledge, dear brother, respected sister, what help you to keep that mindfulness in your heart? What help you to keep like the tear close to your heart, to your eye? What help you to keep that fear close into your heart? That is the knowledge. The knowledge, if someone listen a reminder, for after a while, subhanAllah, he feel like, subhanAllah, his heart is trembling. He feel like almost crying. That's the knowledge that you need. That if you protect this knowledge, when you read the Quran with pondering, you will find those tears, you will find that focus, you will find that contemplation, and then you will find your closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah told us in the Quran, the principle that I have said, it's not something that is being extracted from like study. No, it is in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Anfal concerning the captives that they had in Badr, قَالَ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِمَنْ فِي أَيْدِيكُمْ مِنَ الْأَسْرَى. Say to those who are captives in your hand, إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا. If Allah knows that is in your heart, that in your heart is good, Allah will give you better than what has been taken from you. And Allah will forgive you. So subhanAllah, the mabda, the beginning is what you have in your heart. That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treat you. These people, they were not even believers. But if you come to the belief and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows sincerity in your heart, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is being taken to you, the ransom, Allah is going to double it for you. But the most great thing that Allah will forgive you to come to His path. So it depends what you have in your heart. And your heart, how is defined, how you fill it with, is your own nafs, is your own whims. If you make your whims to be subjected, to be submitted to the way of the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when you save yourself. That when you bring all the goodness in this dunya, you will find the true subhanAllah peace. You will understand the meaning of the true joy. Look at everybody subhanAllah around us. Whatever they get, they ending by being bored. They ending by being sad. Why? Because happiness and joy, it's not in the materialistic thing. Happiness and joy, you find it in your heart. You don't need to travel miles and miles to find an entertainment who's going to make you feel good. You only have it in your heart. If you dig deeper into your heart, you'll find that tranquility. You'll find that goodness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Fath, قَالَ Allah has pleased, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with the believer, those who have been given you their allegiance under the tree. فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. Allah knew in what they're in their heart. In their heart sincerity, in their heart devotion, in their heart love of Allah and the love of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In their heart the love of submit, in their heart to strive in their sake of Allah. عَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. قَالَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ. So He made the tranquility to descend into their heart. And He gave them the glad tidings of an imminent conquest, which was the Fath of Mecca, and a lot of booties that you're going to be gaining. So subhanAllah, by knowing in their heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded them, not to get into a fight, not to meet the enemy, and they get all subhanAllah the benefit of the peace in the heart and in the mind, the benefit of the conquest, which is the triumph and the victory, and the benefit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get them the rizq in very easy way. And this is because of what they had in their heart. Two great obstacles, dear brother, respected sister, to this nafs. To this nafs, to be subhanAllah imprisoned into the nest of the desire. Two big obstacles. The big obstacle, the first one, is the absence of knowledge. And the second one, the absence of the perception. The absence of knowledge, subhanAllah, is not the knowledge that we said of engineering, the knowledge of who is Allah, the knowledge, your relation between you and Allah, the knowledge how weak you are and how great Allah is, how needy you are and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all omnipotent. That's the knowledge that we need. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, حتى إذا جاءوا, when they came to the Day of Judgment, قال أكذبتم بآياتي, you have denied and rejected my ayat, وَلَمْ تُحِيطُ بِهَا عِلْمًا, you didn't even comprehend it. So people are rejecting the ayat of Allah without even taking the time to comprehend and to understand what is the message. قَالَ بَلْ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قَالَ بَلْ كَذَّبُوا بِمَا لَمْ يُحِيطُ بِهِ عِلْمًا. They denied what they didn't even try to comprehend. And this is the absence of knowledge. There is people, subhanAllah, they come to the masjid and think, but they do not even take the time to ask, what is the greatness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why should I love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You didn't even ask the question. If you didn't even try to have that love to really to get into your system, then when you hear the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will be sending the blessing and the prayer by giving you and increasing you in your piety. When you know who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the remembrance and the name, you hear the name of Allah, your heart will tremble out of fear, out of love, out of longing to His meeting subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the absence of the knowledge. So in this absence of the knowledge, then someone will have subhanAllah a corrupted nafs. The second is the perception, and that's the worst. Because when someone subhanAllah, the absence of the perception, he has the perception corrupted, لا يشعر, he cannot even feel it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about the munafiqeen, said, and then when they've been told to correct and do things good on the land, in the land, they said, but we are the people who do it. أَلَا إِنَّهُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ, they are the corruptors. But they could not perceive it. لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Dear brother, respected sister, this fact to not perceive the thing, you don't even feel it. You don't know that you are doing bad. You don't feel it at all. And this is, subhanAllah, what we are falling with this normalization. They do it in all the perspective. The perspective of life, the perspective of akhlaq, the perspective of knowledge. And subhanAllah, when you become like you do not even perceive it, you don't feel it. Someone will be indulging in haram thing and he feels that he's doing good. But these two things, dear brother, respected sister, is a witness and testimony of a corrupted basira. This basira that is inside into your heart, this light that gives you the balance between the good and the evil, that gives you the balance between and the distinction between the true and what is wrong, is gone. And this is subhanAllah, when we have a corrupted basira, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turn away from us. And then our heart will be in the prison of the nafs. And then we'll be serving our desire and wishing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us. It will not happen as long as we didn't try to revive this basira. This basira therefore is your light, this basira is what your guidance. We do not have many time, but I just want to take a little bit of time to help ourselves understand. The basira does not mean that you do a lot of worship, a lot of prayer, a lot of fasting. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said about people, they're going to come and they happen in the time of Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, قَالَ حُدَثَاءُ الْأَسْنَانِ قَالَ وَسُفَهَاءُ الْأَحْلَامِ. They are young in age, but they do not have any reason. They are weak in the reasoning. And the weak in the reasoning, because the absence of the basira, if you have a corrupted insight, then you cannot think. You do not have the ability to reason. You don't have the common sense. You lose the common sense. You look today, subhanAllah, how people, they're fighting about things that does not make sense. That's why, subhanAllah, things are turning upside down, because it had make sense. People, they can argue with them. This is, subhanAllah, is out corrupting and conflicting with the nature of the natural disposition of human being. So these people, when they came, subhanAllah, which they were the Khawarij, when Abdullah ibn Abbas went to, you know, to have munadara, debate with them, he was shocked. He was shocked at what he had seen. People, subhanAllah, they become skinny from fasting. Their faces turn, subhanAllah, pale from sujood. They're reading day and night the Quran. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if I will be at the time when they will come, I will fight them. And he said, these people fighting them is actually a great reward in Allah have to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to understand what was this problem of these people, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, iman didn't go past their throat. It didn't get to the heart. So it's not about how much prayer you do or fasting. That's the extreme way. But for the iman to come to your heart, for the iman to make you a good person, for the iman to make you someone who honest, someone who's true, kind in the way of Allah, just in the way of Allah, someone who's righteous and pious. And these are these days that we are glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you ask your question, what is the best action to help us revive this basir? The best action, dear brother, respected sister, is to contemplate on the favor of Allah upon you. And then to strive to be grateful to this favor. This is what is about the Eid, is to be grateful to the gift of Allah. And the best and the greatest and the core of all the gifts is the oneness of Allah. That's why in this Eid you celebrate and observe the oneness of Allah. You are proud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being your Lord. You are being honored, dignified for Allah to be your Lord. And if you understand that he's a favor upon you, then that's how you revive your basira, and that is how you awake your heart, and that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be taking care of this heart to guide it to his guidance. Therefore you get all the blessing of being with Allah, from being watched, from being protected, from being safeguarded, from being provided, and for being guided to the blissful life that everyone is longing for. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى. أما بعد, the hadith of Abi Bakr رضي الله تعالى عنه, taught to him by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم the dua to shield ourselves from the evil of ourself, from the evil of our nafs. In the hadith that is subhanallah in adhkar al-sabah wal-masa. Therefore when you say subhanallah every morning after you're in the remembrance and the dhikr of the day and in the dhikr of the evening, subhanallah, you understand the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how profound is this aspect or is this subject. And it will not be helpful for us to make the dua and asking Allah to shield ourselves from the evil of ourselves without even contemplating on our evil, without even study the inclination of our nafs. So look at yourself, take a time to look at the inclination of yourself. When the prayer is called, look at the inclination of yourself. You'll find this nafs, subhanAllah, does not want to come. If you want something good, the nafs say, no, I don't want. It's always passive. It's always pulling you. If there is desire, subhanAllah, pushing you to the point that you cannot even help yourself, because the nafs has a power coupled with the power, with the cunning of the shaitan, it puts, subhanAllah, that burning thing into your heart and everything will becomes burning, your face become red, and you'll find yourself helpless just to fall into the sin. If you understand that, if you understand that we are truly weak, that it's easy to be inclined, wallah is easy, Allah is protecting us. One of us thinks that he's righteous, and one of us thinks that he's very, subhanAllah, close to Allah. Wallahi, one incident make him, subhanAllah, to be away from Allah. If someone, he has weakness toward, subhanAllah, women, if a woman will call him, he will not resist. If someone has weakness toward money, if something of money haram it has, and subhanAllah, luring, he will not resist. Why? Because we are weak, not because we are bad. So when you're making this dua, you're making dua to protect you. Truly you want to protect yourself because you want the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want for Allah help and nasr. And the nasr of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the nasr of Allah, the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is near. But is near in distance or near in time? No, it's near, it's always near. Who is then far from this triumph? Who is then far from his help? This help is ourselves. Because we're holding ourselves back from this hell. So if you liberate ourselves, that's the meaning of freedom. The freedom is not to indulge in the desire that you want. The freedom is to free yourself so you can be in enable yourself to really come close to Allah. Enable yourself to really protect yourself from the imprisonment of the nafs. Enable yourself to can march toward the help of Allah, to the victory of Allah, to the triumph of Allah, to the nearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فاللهم طهر قلوبنا يا أرحم الراحمين من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء. اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وأعيننا من الخيانة. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه, وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم تقبل منا يا أرحم الراحمين أعمالنا في هذه الأيام المباركة, واجعله عيدا مباركا علينا, وثبتنا يا أرحم الراحمين على الصراط المستقيم. اللهم اهدي قلوبنا إلى الخير. اللهم اهدي قلوبنا إلى الخير ومكن فيه الإيمان, واجعل بصيرتنا مضيئة يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم تب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم توفنا مسلمين. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين, وأقم الصلاة يرحمكم الله.